alaikum, hello and welcome to the Health Show, here only on the Islam Channel with me, Alistair Greener. Here we are in our third season and the very first episode, where every week we take a look at everyday health concerns that we, our family or our loved ones may face. We like to introduce you to health experts in their specialised field and look at alternative viewpoints to the health concern being discussed. If you suffer from any medical concern whatsoever, then please do watch every week as we do cover a wide variety of health concerns. You can get in touch with us each week as well by email healthshow@islamchannel.tv. Now, we're a great pleasure today to be able to welcome the team from the London Clinic. And joining me is Dr. Pixie McKenna, who may be a familiar face to you as she comes from that award-winning and BAFTA-winning show Embarrassing Bodies on Channel 4. She also specialises in lifestyle screening because she is a GP as well at the London Clinic, and she's been working for over 13 years in the NHS and also in private healthcare. It's great to see you. Thank you so much indeed for joining us.
Glad to be here.
We've got lots to talk about, and we have already met, but we will find out more about that in a little while. First of all, let's find out a little bit more about the London Clinic. Now, this is actually one of the UK's largest private hospitals, and it looks at specialised personal health care. Let's find out a little bit more from this clip. A very brief look at your clinic. I want to talk first of all about your own work as a GP, because many people who are familiar with you on TV think that's great, something's on TV telling us all about our healthcare, but forget sometimes about the background that you have in medicine. Tell us a little bit more about how you got into medicine and becoming a GP.
Well, I've been a doctor for half of my life, so I've been a doctor long more than I've been on the telly. And I always wanted to be a GP when I was very small, so that was my sort of goal. As soon as I could medicate my teddy bears, I was off. I've come from a long line of family doctors, so it was sort of the natural progression into general practice. And I guess I've worked in private healthcare for probably about two decades now. Don't want to tell you my age. And I love it. It's great. I work as a GP, the same as any other GP. I suppose the luxury of our service is that we're able to give people a little bit more time, and we're able to go through their problems from head to toe rather than them having just to have one specific problem. So I enjoy that aspect about it. I think it gives us the opportunity to do what is really very much the tool in general practice, which is getting to know our patients.
And interestingly enough, you work, we're going to be talking about the preventative side in a moment and the health checks and so on, but also people who actually come to you with various symptoms and various concerns. That's very much a core part of your business.
Absolutely. And, you know, I suppose having worked on shows like Embarrassing Bodies, I really understand that people may have an ailment that they're too ashamed of, they're too shy to do anything about, or actually they feel that they can't open that dialogue with a doctor for whatever reason. It's a number of reasons. And sometimes they then do something else, like ask a friend, or they might go on the internet and consult Dr. Google, when actually the best place is come in and tell us, or your own GP, and we can either reassure you that there's nothing wrong, or we can refer you.
And that's an interesting point, isn't it? Because if people are reluctant to go and see you if they've got symptoms, then you can understand the reluctance to come and see you and have a preventative health check when, to them, nothing's wrong.
Absolutely. And I suppose, you know, it has to be said, the worst culprits are them. men. You know, men hate going to the doctor. And men have this, women do it as well, but men are really, really, really commonly, they do what's called the door handle cond as they go out. They eventually get the appointment for the doctor, they go to the doctor, and they come in and talk about something, which has got nothing to do with the reason they made the appointment in the first place. And as they've got their hand on the door, they look back at you and they say, can I just ask? And that's the reason they wanted to come in. But that's fine, we can deal with that too, we can get you back in. You know, the main thing is, we need to have time for you and we need to be able to iron out all your problems and get you on the right track.
I think the biggest message probably is the fact that as a doctor, as a GP, you have heard it all before.
There's always some smarty pants, some kind of symptom or some kind of thing to show me that makes me go, But yeah, we pretty much have. So, you know, don't be ashamed. Don't be embarrassed. Don't put it off. Now is the time. Do it.
And this thing you mentioned about men versus women, why are men that much more reluctant to come to the doctor, whether it be for symptoms or whether it be for something preventative like this?
I think women are often the core people in a household that will deal with doctors. We tend to go to doctors more for various reasons of female anatomy, you know, having babies. We'll be the ones probably that will take our children to the doctors. Not exclusively, every family is different. And I think that we're very much still seen as the kind of caregivers and care receivers. And men just kind of, you know, they just get on with it. And they don't, I guess, like asking for help. There's a macho thing. There's definitely a fear thing. You know, what if it was cancer? What if it was heart disease? And that's a big deterrent. And believe you me, the amount of men that come in, and for some reason, because I'm called Dr. McKenna, assume I'm male. And then get a fright when they come in the door and they go, oh, I thought you'd be a man.
That's really interesting, isn't it? Because people do have these preconceptions all the time. And one of the things that we often hear on this show is how particularly the BAME community sometimes seem even more reluctant to come and see you. Is there any reason for that?
I think sometimes, and that may be through family tradition and culture, people source out help just outside of the healthcare sector. And they may have people within their community or their family who are their go-to people for everything from a financial matter to a personal matter to a health matter. And then sometimes I guess that means that they maybe overlook the severity of something or they don't get the exact answer. So I would always encourage anyone, if it's a medical issue, go and talk to your doctor. And set aside the time and know what you're going to, you know, have maybe a little crib list, know what you're going to talk to them about, and don't leave until you've got an answer or you've got some kind of action plan.
And interestingly, culturally, it can make a big difference to people whether they're seeing a female or a male doctor.
Of course, absolutely. And, you know, obviously, we're an all-female practice, so we see lots of ladies. We see lots of men as well. But that's very important. If you want to wait to see a male or a female, then wait that little bit of time and see the doctor that you feel you can open up to and actually have a very honest and frank discussion about your symptoms and also an examination where you feel comfortable. Because there's nothing worse than being in a situation where you are anxious because you won't give yourself, I guess, the justice of your complaint and then you may not end up getting the right treatment.
And when it comes to preventative healthcare, having these health checks, at what sort of age do you reckon that people should start having them? Or does it depend maybe on their family history?
I think family history is really, really important. And people who have family history of things like heart disease, so, you know, first cousins, siblings, parents who've had things like strokes and heart attacks at a young age, so under 50, cancers. 50 is like it's a bit like a line in the sand where health is concerned. As doctors, we get incredibly prejudiced once you go over the age of 50, because more things can go wrong. So in terms of health checks, personally, I think people should start doing these probably once they hit 40. There's no harm in doing them when, you know, more checks, there's no harm in going to the doctor and getting things sorted out. But between 40 and 50, I think you have a wonderful opportunity to shape the future. Because at 50, things naturally start to not work properly or diseases are more prevalent. But certainly if you have a family history of problems under 50 and very much under 40, then you should consider screening sooner.
And it's interesting, we hear about this term door handle conversation and the role of a GP. For some people, they might actually, you know, if they've never been to the doctors, it's just something, especially if they're men, they've never had to encounter that. Let's take it back to the real basics of what actually happens when you go along and you see your GP.
I mean, you come into your GP, and as far as I'm concerned, anything can walk through the door. Any symptom, any state of wellness to someone who literally in 5 minutes you're calling an ambulance or you're going to have to admit them. And we deal with problems from head to toe, from the physical to the psychological, to the wacky and the way out, to the really basic, am I normal? Is this okay? Should I be doing this? So it's vast in general practice. We're often called, you know, jack of all trades, master of none. But I think as a GP, the longer you're a GP as well, you have seen so many different things. We're usually able to tease out what the problem is. And if we can't deal with it ourselves, we know the right person to pass you on to. So hopefully, as I say to patients all the time, never leave a doctor's surgery without a plan.
I would like to talk a little bit more about the process of going through this medical screening and medical health check. First of all, there'll be some people who say, you know what, I'm perfectly healthy, thank you very much, I'll go when there's some symptom. What would you say to those people to say that, you know what, you're 45, you're 50, you're 55, you really should come?
I call them the doctor dodgers, the people who say, oh, I never go to the doctor. Just because you never go to the doctor, don't assume you're not unwell. Common things are common, and disease processes, once you go over the age of 50, certainly are more prevalent. And that's cancer, diabetes, heart disease, plus lifestyle issues, obesity, hypertension, cholesterol problems. So I think, you know, those who feel that they don't need to go, I think everybody needs some type of baseline checkup. You know, the National Health is doing it once you hit the age of 40. It's offering you a check for the salient things that we're worried about, the things that are making us unwell, or if we are living long into older age, we're not living well enough. And I think those are the things you should be screening for.
And it's interesting you mentioned the NHS there, because that's a little bit of a lottery in terms of what you get according to the different regions. Tell us a little bit more about the London Clinic and what it is that you do, and maybe how you go above and beyond what you could expect from an NHS checkup.
I mean, look, in the ideal world, everyone would have access to everything. At the London Clinic, within our practice, what we try and focus on is age-appropriate investigations, because some people don't need particular tests because they're young and their risks are so low, those tests are actually irrelevant. So we focus on the important things. Cancer, 1 in 3 of us are going to get cancer. The statistics for cancer are going to get worse and worse. So a fact of 1 in 3, I think you've got to have a cancer focus to your screening. Heart disease, really, really prevalent in men. A big plague in Britain, so very important to screen things like cholesterol, blood pressure, diabetes, very important. We're all getting bigger around the middle, and that in itself is a risk factor for type 2 diabetes. And alongside of that, obesity. Literally, it is only a matter of time, a very small amount of time, before obesity is level with smoking when it comes to a cancer risk factor.
It's funny you talk about obesity in a bit more around the middle, and I find myself breathing at that point. And I have to come clean that actually I did come along to you a while ago for a health check, which we will talk more about in the second half. But what's the difference between, you said a very short amount of time between it becoming critical. So how much of a difference can it make to somebody getting that early diagnosis that something comes up in a health check that maybe they were completely unaware of? And maybe you've got some examples of how that's actually come about.
I suppose if you look at simple tests, and these would be tests that actually are available on the NHS as well when you reach a certain age. If you look at the mammogram, for example, the mammogram can pick something up on that particular scan probably 4 years before you would present to your doctor with a symptom. The bowel cancer screening test, which is everyone goes, oh, I don't want to do it because you have to send a specimen of your bowel motions in the post. Some people are very uncomfortable with that. That test can pick up things like polyps in your colon, bleeding that you haven't seen, and that may be preventing you from getting a cancer diagnosis, an invasive, really serious cancer diagnosis, 5 to 10 years down the line. Even looking at things like your skin, looking at lumps and bumps and moles, I think just being proactive is very, very important. But those two tests in particular, cholesterol as well, you know, we can tell from your cholesterol, your blood pressure, your weight, your height, your family history, we can predict your chances of getting a stroke or a heart attack in the next 10 years.
Wow. I mean, that's pretty powerful, isn't it?
You know, so it's really important.
And thinking about people, you know, who come along to you for this check, is there anything that you do that actually is pretty difficult to get on the NHS? So it's something else that might give an extra indication?
I suppose the thing that we do is, that most importantly, I think, is that the patient has the time to sit there and go through everything from head to toe, from the day they were born to the day they are now, where they are now, in terms of their symptoms, their past medical history, their relevant lifestyle history, their family history, you know, down to the nitty-gritty of how much they sleep, what they do at the weekend. We've got that time to curate all of that together and create this picture of the patient. Because, of course, as they always tell you in medical school, it's not just about the laying on of hands and the looking at test results. The key is very often in the story as well. And I think time is one of the greatest luxuries of private practice.
And it's interesting, we went through that, and some of the questions that you were asking me, which we'll see in the second half of the show, was, I suppose, a way of you finding out of things that actually, we'll look at that, we'll focus on that a little bit more, because that could be something. So there's a lot of questions there, though, that you ask, aren't there?
Yeah, and you know, you can't, I defy any patient, myself included, to sit down and remember all your medical history and spout it all off. So what we do is we have a series of questions, kind of the same. Every doctor has the same sort of set of questions on every part of your anatomy that they will ask, that will prompt you to disclose symptoms that may be hugely relevant. So things to us, we call them red flags, that we might go, aha, okay, you know, you're passing blood from somewhere that is abnormal, or you've lost a lot of weight, or you're very fatigued. And then that might take us off on a little segue down here, and we might discover more and more and more. You know, it's like going into court as a lawyer, and you think, he said that, let's dig down that way. That's given us a little bit of a clue. So a lot of it is investigative, but the story is a big thing.
And what about the particular issues that you may consider? Because, there are cultural differences to healthcare. Are there things that, again, to the BAME community that you think, okay, we might spend a little bit more time looking at that area of health versus that area of health? Are there, to use your phrase, red flags that you might consider more with this community?
I think certainly, there are common things are common to all of us in terms of cancers, but also looking at things like, for example, vitamin D deficiency is quite a common one. Being overweight, type 2 diabetes, so we have to think of all of those things. And I think across the board, as a doctor, what's quite important is never to be assumptive or presumptive because the person lives in a certain way or lives in a certain place. We can never assume. We should never assume as doctors, and therefore our line of questioning, sometimes you might go, that, and it might be wholly irrelevant to you, but we tend to, I think there is a catch-all, really, that will cover most things for most communities, and plus it's very important as well for patients, I think, I feel, as doctors, we probably don't ask the question enough, is that, what are you worried about? What's made you come here today to have a check when you might have had this problem for 3 months, 3 years? Listen, I've seen patients who've had something for 30 years and they've come in and they've never seen a doctor before about it. Now, clearly, isn't something that's going to have killed them because they've been alive. So, what is the motivation?
And it's interesting you say motivation, because sometimes the reason people don't go is because they think it's going to be uncomfortable or it's going to be embarrassing or so on. And as someone who's been through the process, actually it's as far from that as you can imagine. Talk us through how long it takes and the sorts of things that you're going to do when people come in for a medical screening.
I suppose the first thing to say about a medical screening is you're going to have blood tests, okay? So you're going to have to fast for those blood tests. So that means you can't have anything except water. You can have black tea, black coffee, but nothing else. No sneaky croissants or anything like that. You know, people cheat.
No.
Yes. So, you know, don't come in and then go, oh, well, actually. So that's the first thing. You're going to have to fast. You're going to be asked to provide a sample of urine. So bear that in mind. Can't tell you how many patients, you know, it's sort of what we were kind of drilled into us, I suppose, as kids, you know, you go to the loo before you leave the house, etc. So ideally, save it up for us, and then you can give the specimen when you arrive, or if you need to use the bathroom, tell the receptionist, I need to use the bathroom. I'm sure the doctor's going to ask me for the sample of urine. Get that job out of the way. Dress for the occasion. Layers and layers and layers of things, or not feeling comfortable, just anticipate you're going to have an examination. And for older people who might be in their 50s, that would maybe an examination if it's a man of the prostate, an internal examination if it's a female, in terms of gynecology, breast examination. So anticipate all those type of things. If you don't want to have any of those tests, you just say to the doctor, I'm not happy with having that today. If you go away and you think, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't have that, get back in touch, come back in, we'll do it for you.
And I have to say, the process, having, as I say, been through it, it's very simple, very easy, and actually very comfortable. We're going to talk more after the break, but we are going to have to take a very quick break now, where Dr. McKenna is going to be joined by one of her colleagues, where we'll be talking more about the London Clinic, what they do, and we'll also be talking more about the benefits of preventative health screening. Don't go anywhere, we'll be right back. Hello and welcome back to the Health Show, where today we're talking about private health checks. Joining me is Dr. Pixie McKenna from the London Clinic, and also joining us is Lisa Das, who's a consultant gastroenterologist. I practice that. We're here to talk about all types of health screening and health checks. And Lisa, thanks very much indeed for joining us, because one of the big areas where we don't know what's going on always is in our insides, as it were. First of all, tell us what exactly you do, because for people who don't understand what a gastroenterologist is.
It's quite a long term, I understand. But it's all about the inside of the digestive tract. So that's anywhere from the mouth to the bottom end. It includes the stomach and the small intestine, as well as the colon, but also the liver and the pancreas. So we deal with all of the digestive organs.
And the big thing is that a lot of the problems in that part of the body won't necessarily manifest themselves until quite a bit further down the line.
There's so many symptoms that can be attributed, and people come in with, for instance, abdominal pain, and that could be due to an infection or ulceration. It could be due to inflammation in the bowel or polyps. So it's not very easy to discern, you know, which part of the gut you're dealing with.
And what will actually happen if somebody comes for a health check at the London Clinic? Would they first of all see you, Dr. Pixie, and then you would refer to Lisa, or how would that normally work?
So if somebody came and they had symptoms that might suggest they had an ulcer, or if we did some of our standard screening tests, for example, a blood test that revealed them to be anemic, and there wasn't any obvious cause, then one of the first places we might look is blood loss from the gut. Or we do also do a test which screens the bowel motions for hidden blood. It's called the fecal occult blood test. And if you test positive on that test, then that means there's a little bit of bleeding going on somewhere in your lower digestive tract. And that would inevitably put you in line for one of Lisa's endoscopies.
And it's really important to get these done early. You know, you hear all the time about how someone had a screening and actually something showed up, and actually it was not overly difficult to deal with, but later on it's very difficult.
I think screening is really important, because that's essentially detecting disease before symptoms happen. So if one wants to be preventative bowel cancer screening, which we're very lucky to have the NHS National Screening Programme, is one of the most preventative tests we can have. So if you think at the age of 60, almost 40% of people will have a polyp, so a little growth in the bowel, and these are asymptomatic. And if you do the colonoscopy and you take them away, you've taken away the risk of that polyp becoming cancerous. So it's a very useful tool.
tell us exactly what happens when you do look into the gut and the whole digestive system in more detail. It involves a couple of tubes, doesn't it?
Very small tubes, very flexible tubes, and there's a preconception that these are difficult tests or uncomfortable. They really don't need to be. You can have them with sedation or without, that's your preference. There is a bit of a clean out for the colonoscopy, which everyone is quite devastated to hear they're going to have to take, but that's the hardest part of the test, really. And then we use a flexible tube through which we can actually take polyps out and take biopsies. And the test takes about half an hour for the colonoscopy and about 10 minutes for the endoscopy looking at the stomach. And we have a result straight away, and it's the best way of looking at the digestive tract because a CT scan or an X-ray doesn't give the same information.
And it is incredible when you see that, you know, literally you can watch it if you want to, you can watch it all live on TV.
Yeah, we encourage it, yes. it's nice to see the inside, and people are amazed how amazing it looks.
But they don't have to look, I should say, just in case they don't want to. Now, one of the interesting things is that's obviously one of the things that you get referred to by someone like Dr. McKenna. In terms of the health check, and actually it's the part I've been dreading now, because I did come along to you for a health check a while ago, and I went through that whole process that we've been describing in the first half of the show. I don't know what all the results were yet, so should we have a look?
Yes.
Okay, let's take a look.
Just run through a few basic questions about your various systems, your heart, your lungs, your eyes, your energy, etc. And how do you feel at the moment? Do you feel fine, lots of energy?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. Good.
Let's start from the top and work down. In terms of your eyesight, how is your eyesight?
I wear reading glasses,
yeah.
But I also have a lazy eye. So my left eye is basically minimal function.
And any problems with your hearing?
No.
No. Have you had any issues with nasal congestion, throat problems, anything like that? No?
No. Right.
Any difficulty swallowing?
No.
Any problems with indigestion, acid reflux?
Very, very rarely. I mean, to the minimal point where it's obviously something I've just eaten that moment rather than on a regular basis.
And you haven't passed any blood or slime or mucus with the bowel motions?
Not in the world, no.
How has your weight been over the last 12 months?
Fairly consistent. I know that I'm a few pounds overweight. I currently weigh about 82, 83 kilos, something like that.
Do you smoke?
No.
Were you ever a smoker?
No smoking at all.
Do you drink alcohol?
Yes.
And how much alcohol do you drink?
About 26 units a week.
Okay. Ooh, right.
Which is a little on the higher side. Yeah.
20.
Yeah.
Do you have, is that spread out over 7 days or is it, do you have alcohol-free days?
Normally I'll have two or three alcohol-free days a week.
But you have days off, which is very, very important to give your liver a little bit of a break. So tell me about your cholesterol. You said in the past it's been slightly high?
I had a test about 7 years ago, and at that point it was definitely about 7 point something. I can't remember exactly what it was, but it was definitely heightened, and I was quite surprised because I thought, I'm not that overweight, my diet isn't that bad, you know, so that was a bit of a shock, but it was good to find out, so at least I knew that I could do something about it.
I mean, cholesterol is one of the things that we will look at today, so, you know, when you're doing a health screen, I suppose we're looking for common things and the common causes of you know, morbidity and mortality in our general patients. So cardiovascular disease, so heart disease, strokes, so we're looking at parameters like cholesterol, blood pressure, that type of thing. Okay, diabetes is a very big problem for the UK at the moment, very much so directly related to the fact that our population is getting larger. We will also look at your basic parameters of liver function, kidney function, and then in terms of cancers, which of course is something that we're seeing more and more of. Lifetime risk currently of cancer is now 1 in 3 from the day you're born till the day you die. So it's very, very important to know what the important major cancers. So in someone of your age, you'd be looking at skin cancer, bowel cancer, and prostate cancer, and checking various markers. So to assess those, we'll have a look at your skin. We'll do a blood test for prostate. We've obviously got a handle on your symptoms. We'll check your urine, and we can also check your prostate gland. In terms of skin cancer, we'll have a look at all your moles. And then in terms of bowel screening, and this is the test that most patients don't like doing, we'll give you a little specimen pot so that you can give us a sample of your bowel motions, and then that will be analysed looking for hidden blood. Okay?
Okay.
So, and then, so through the blood work, we will pick up a lot. It tells us a lot based on your examination, your history, and your blood. It sort of pieces all the jigsaw together. We join the dots. And the key thing is really what we want to do is we want to do age-appropriate screening. Common things are common at particular decades in your life. So, you know, we need to focus on what's important. Yes, of course, you could check for every single thing under the sun, and you could scan head to toe and do a million blood tests. But the key thing is focusing on the important things and the things that are likely in someone of your age. Medicine is very, very prejudiced once you go over the age of 50, and therefore we're a lot stricter about things like blood pressure and weight and things that we analyse, and we look at things and symptoms much more closely and have a higher incidence, I guess, of referring people for further tests based on what we find. So you can get away with a lot when you're younger, so unfortunately we might be a little bit stricter on you.
I have to say that is exactly what happened, and that is exactly what would happen for anybody who came in for a health check, isn't it?
Yes. And it can also be tailored to their needs. If they want something additional or if they don't want to do something, we'll work around whatever it is, whatever their concerns are. Absolutely.
One thing that we hadn't talked about before was the extra screening that I had, which was, I think, looking at my bones. Perhaps you can talk us a little bit through that.
We had what's called a VAT scan and a bone density scan. So it looked at the density of your bones, and it also looked at your visceral fat. So that's the fat, basically the fat you have around your organs. Do you want to know your stuff?
I think we better have. Okay, so people will be wondering what's going on.
Your bones were fine. You had a tiny little bit of extra fat around your organs, but nothing that would concern us. But in the general population, we do worry about visceral fat if there's too much visceral fat, because it poses a risk for other diseases, for example, things like diabetes. So it's important to I guess, you know, reverts back to the thing that the doctor always says about losing weight. Eat less, move more. But
it's interesting because it's inside, so you can't see it, so you can't be aware of it.
Yes, exactly.
And that obviously is then going to affect the function of your vital organs.
Well, for example, I mean, what we see a lot of in the UK now is people who have impaired liver function because of fat, there being fat around that area, and the liver isn't as flexible and as it was, so they get a little bit of what we call fibrosis. So, yeah, it's important. It's very important.
And is it possible to have this internal visceral fat without the external signs of it?
You'll usually have some external signs of it, usually. Right. And I suppose, you know, for someone watching at home, the most basic thing to do is measure around your abdomen, so measure what we call your waist circumference around your belly button, and then also measure your height and weight and do your body mass index. And you'll work out where you fall in the general population.
And looking at that particular test and looking at things, all the questions you were asking me were the standard questions. But again, if I had gone into certain areas of my health, that might have raised red flags. So that would have led you down the path of more questions in that particular area.
Of course, yeah. So for example, in terms of your bowels, you know, if you said, well, my bowel habit has changed over the last couple of months. I used to go every day. Now I go every 3 days. I've had a little bit of blood, etc. Then that would have gone a little bit, okay, let's explain what are the bowel motions like, etc. Have you lost weight? Do you feel tired? Have you had tummy pain? So it just gives us a little bit of a prompt. But of course, we can only go down those avenues, one, if we ask the right questions, and two, if you give honest answers. Never be afraid to give an honest answer to a doctor.
I was going to say that that's always one of those bizarre things, isn't it, where people sometimes might tell you something that's not entirely true, and then it comes up later. I mean, you must notice that particular when looking inside people's systems, that doesn't lie, I presume.
It definitely doesn't. But I think it is important to be honest. It's the only way that we can help you to ascertain, you know, how we can investigate you appropriately.
And one of the things that, you know, we talked about IBS or irritable bowel syndrome, that's that it's becoming quite common, isn't it?
It's been quite common. It's actually the diagnosis that's most commonly seen by a gastroenterologist. So about 1 in 20 people worldwide will have IBS-type symptoms, and that can be anything from bloating to abdominal pain to some change in the bowel habits also. And I think the important thing to know is people who live with IBS, we only see the top of the pyramid. There's many people who deal with this day to day, but that can be confused with other diseases too. So I think it's always important to have that frank discussion.
And it's very easy to spot, is it, to be able to diagnose if someone comes in for the correct checks?
There's certain diagnostic criteria. Oftentimes for us, we see people who've seen 4 or 5 different gastroenterologists because they've been given a diagnosis, and they're not terribly confident that that was the right diagnosis. But there are certain criteria to meet. But if anything seems out of the ordinary, again, getting a different consultation is helpful to cast another set of eyes on it and just see, is this IBS or is there something underlying?
Now, obviously, this is something which is very much involved with your diet, with what you're eating, because what you're putting inside your body has a direct effect on your digestive system. Are you able then to give further advice and help with people if they, for example, Dr. McKenna, show that they do have something within their digestive system that you can actually help them with their diet? And I'm thinking particularly within the BAME community, some wonderful foods that are eaten sometimes might not be conducive to these conditions.
Well, certainly for IBS, now we use a thing called the FODMAP diet quite a lot. Lisa would obviously be much more of an expert on than I am. And we would usually encourage patients actually to see a dietitian, to work with the dietitian on a diet like the FODMAP diet, because it's quite tough to stick to. And you need someone coaching you and working with you and looking at how realistically, because there's no point, you know, doctors are great at saying, oh, go and do this, but we're not living in your shoes. And it has to fall within how you lead your life and the restrictions that you have. So it's important to have someone that's working with you specifically on a diet.
And again, being honest about what you can and can't practically do is essential.
It is, because we you know, there are constraints for all of us, whether that's the time of day you go to work versus how you eat, who cooks your food, restrictions you might have with allergies, etc., etc. There's a whole host of factors, really, down to your job and actually down to how your life is going. If your life isn't going very well for you and you're in a particularly stressful situation, your irritable bowel syndrome is going to be bad.
And coming back to the health check process, you've really touched there on the follow-up procedure. In other words, you've discovered something, you're aware, for example, that maybe an endoscopy is necessary or so. Talk us through that process of being in touch with the patient afterwards and the next steps.
Well, it's very important to have a plan. So when you leave, you then get a report with all your results in it, explanation of what's significant, what's not significant. When patients are given reports, sometimes blood results and there's things asterisked and red lines and stuff. As a doctor, you look at that and you go, don't worry about that, don't worry about that. Oh, that's a worry. But for a patient, if we don't explain every little slight detail, they'll be sitting at home at 10 o'clock at night, they'll see a star next to something, which isn't clinically significant, but we need to put it all down on paper so that they understand. And then work on a plan in terms of the symptoms you've discussed. Has anything come up that might give us a diagnosis, and what do we do moving forward? How are we going to improve your symptoms? Do you need a referral, or actually have you been reassured, and have I, as the doctor, been reassured that there is nothing wrong with you, and you're not going to come back next month and say, oh, look what I have now. And that's really the crux of it, really. But it's very important to establish a plan and know that all of these things have been checked and what the next steps are.
How routine was my health check compared to the hundreds that you do?
I've probably done, I don't know, 3,000 screens, more, oh, I don't know, millions, hundreds of them. They're all different types of patients. I would say you are bog standard, healthy, chap. You didn't tell me anything that made me worry at all. You don't have any significantly adverse lifestyle habits. You're fit, you enjoy your job. You don't have any bad family history, your past medical history, and your general inquiry of your symptoms from head to toe didn't prompt me to go, oh. But interestingly, Alistair, a couple of things came up in your blood test.
Right, okay.
So when we ran your we ran liver function, kidney function, blood test for diabetes, cholesterol, thyroid function, a full hematology profile, which would look at iron, it would look at white blood cells, platelets, which are cells for clotting, your inflammatory markers, markers of how inflamed and irritated your blood is, cholesterol, vitamin D. So we looked at all of those, and there was a couple of things. The first thing was one of your markers of thyroid function was outside the range, which, looking at it, suggested to me that actually your thyroid gland is on a bit of a go-slow, that it's sluggish and that it's not working as efficiently. And when we had our chat, which didn't come up on the screen here, there was a family history of thyroid in your family.
That's right, yeah.
So
that's almost the explanation for why I might have it. Or is it something that diet and lifestyle can affect?
It wouldn't really be impacted by diet and lifestyle. It's much more a common disease in women, actually, than men. But there's obviously something, I think, you can probably blame your mother for that one.
She'll have to hear that.
Your cholesterol was high. Mm-hmm. And, one of the things, I remember looking at the results and I was going, this guy does Nutribullets and hip blocks and all kinds of things. And of course, what we know about the thyroid gland is because it's involved in metabolism and yours wasn't functioning as well as it should be, that tends to slow things down and that can push the cholesterol up. And in the parameters of cholesterol, we look at two, we look at good cholesterol and bad cholesterol, we call them HDL cholesterol. So, in layman's terms, that's highly desirable cholesterol, versus LDL cholesterol, which is least desirable cholesterol. And you had quite a lot of the bad stuff. So in my head, I'm thinking, if we can normalize the thyroid, that in turn should normalize or certainly improve the cholesterol values.
That's really interesting how one thing in the body can affect something else. I mean, you must notice it when you're doing endoscopies and so on, how one function can affect something else. And unfortunately, we've only got a couple of minutes left, which is why I saved this in this latest moment. But what are the sort of things that someone like me should be doing as a result of this? And especially with the cholesterol, because that is a concern.
So definitely a low cholesterol diet, but also thyroid supplementation. You need to take something to get your thyroid back on track. And the other thing that we picked up was vitamin D. You were deficient in vitamin D. Very, very important. And quite a common problem across the board. Vitamin D you either source from the sun, which we don't get a lot of, or you source through supplements. You're only going to get about 10% of your vitamin D that you require from your diet. So diet, doesn't matter how much oily fish you eat, it's not happening in terms of boosting your levels. So that's important. So we need to give you a supplement of vitamin D to take. I'm going to give you a loading supplement now to improve your dose over the next 5 to 7 weeks. And then I genuinely think that you need to remain on a vitamin D supplement, just one, 20,000 units a month for the rest of your life.
Wow. And it's interesting that something like this can come up with a health check. Now, I wouldn't have known, as we discussed on the VT there, that I wasn't presenting with any symptoms. I wasn't aware of any of these things. And this, to me, is the real value of a health check, that I suppose the phrase I would use is to head it off at the pass, as it were. Because if I didn't correct any of these things, if I didn't address the vitamin D deficiency, the cholesterol, the thyroid, What could be the knock-on consequences over a period of time?
Well, anyone going around with high cholesterol, it's like a ticking time bomb. You know, it can affect your arteries, the big arteries, but also the small arteries to, you know, your eyes, etc. So that's important. It clogs the arteries. So we've got to sort that out because it's a risk factor for heart disease and stroke. The thyroid would slow down your metabolism. That might make you gain weight, make you feel tired, make you feel a bit sluggish and, you know, not be as sharp and sparky as you usually are. Constipate you, give you dry skin, your hair could fall out. I mean, thyroid, you name it, it does it. And then vitamin D also makes you feel tired, aches and pains in your bones if you haven't got enough of it. And in the winter time, puts you in line for getting a lot more infections. You tend to pick up more infections in the winter time, the common cold, you might have it more frequently if you're low in vitamin D.
Wow, so some big things to be there.
All and straightforward.
And great to know at this stage, yeah. Because as you say, it's a slight change in what I do. And likewise, coming to you, Lisa, with people who maybe present with something where you've had to do an examination. Again, what are the typical kind of things that you're able to do, which are fairly minor changes, but can have huge benefits later on?
I think the diet is really important. Vitamin D also plays a huge role in the gut health too. There's studies looking at vitamin D and the risk of colorectal cancer, which seems to be increased if it's deficient. But I think the best thing that we do is colonoscopy with polypectomy. So if you take the polyps off, you've essentially put that person into a different risk category, and we just observe whether that's a colonoscopy every 5 years or every 10 years. At least you know you're being taken care of, and if we can take polyps out when they're small, then essentially we can prevent colorectal cancer from happening.
Fantastic. Well, it's been great talking to you. Thank you so much indeed as well for taking me through the whole process. I, for one, am certainly convinced there's a massive benefit for having a health check so that you can head things off in the past, so you can prevent problems further down the line. As you say, taking you away from potential risks that might manifest itself later on in life. Thank you both very much indeed for coming in, Dr. McKenna, Dr. Das. It's been great to have you. And thank you also to the London Clinic.
Thank you.
Well, that is all the time we have for this particular show. Just the first in our series, our third series here of The Health Show. Please do tune in again next week. We've got lots of great topics over the course of this series. In the meantime, if you have any questions about this or any health concerns whatsoever, please do email us, healthshow@islamchannel.tv. In the meantime, thank you again to our guests. Thank you for joining us.